Just a few days ago, Microsoft announced Windows 365, which is a subscription service for cloud PCs. It's aimed at businesses, so average users can't really go out and get this, and you really wouldn't exactly want to. We'll get to that in a minute. But I did go and test out some of these virtual computers, and we can see sort of how they perform. The basic idea for how to use them is you'd have your regular computer, it might be a super basic computer, and then you can connect and basically stream the image of that virtual computer and still control it and stuff, and it might be more powerful, or it might just be able to run certain programs that you necessarily wouldn't be able to on your personal computer. Or in terms of business, it's just easier for them to set up a bunch of virtual PCs than real ones, and then users might be able to connect with their personal PCs or just a very basic company-issued PC and then connect to the more powerful virtual one. Taking a look at the pricing page, they have three plans on here, but these are basically just common example plans. If you actually look at all of them, they range in a wide variety of pricing and capabilities. For example, the absolute bare minimum you can get is one virtual CPU with 2 gigabytes of RAM, 64 gigabytes of storage, and that is $24 per month per user. I don't know about you, but 2 gigabytes of RAM almost seems like I barely would not even be able to use that, I don't think. However, it currently does scale all the way up to an option of 8 virtual CPUs, 32 gigabytes of RAM, 512 gigabytes of storage, and that costs $162 per user per month. So that's quite expensive, really. In between, there's several different combinations of different computers varying from 1, 2, 4, or 8 CPUs, and with 2, 4, 8, 16, or 32 gigabytes of RAM, and 64, 128, 256, and 512 gigabytes of storage, and different combinations thereof. Though there is something called hybrid benefit, where if you're running a computer running Windows 10 Pro already, then you get like a slight discount on the cloud PC. Now, as for those three example configurations on the main page, Microsoft was actually offering free 2-month trials for these three options for just one day. And now it says that there was unprecedented demand and they paused the free trials. However, I was able to yesterday sign up for the basic one and the premium one. The one important thing to point out is even yesterday when the free trials were available, you could not even sign up as a regular user. You had to have a business account basically or access to the Microsoft Admin Center, which I know you can get if you have a domain and then you attach a Microsoft account to the domain and set it up that way. I'm not sure if you can even do it without a domain, and it's kind of a pain anyway. It's definitely for businesses, not something very user-friendly. So an average person would not even be able to sign up for one of these trials. You had to have a special type of account. Another thing you'll notice is there's two different types of plans, business or enterprise. They seem to be basically the same price. However, it looks like enterprise just has what's called Microsoft Endpoint Manager is the only main difference I saw, and also unlimited users versus 300 max users for business plan. So it seems like the enterprise plan might just have some more options for tying it into bigger systems. I don't know, something like that. So I'll walk you through the setup process. It really didn't actually take that long. So you go to windows365.com. That's where this whole main page is. I clicked trial and then hit continue. Though again, remember it requires the admin center, which I already have. So I probably didn't have to go through a whole bunch of setup here. And it just added the computer to my account, and it showed up under product list in the admin center. And then I was able to assign the virtual computer to a user, which is just myself. And then I had access to it at the Windows 365 dashboard, I guess you'll call it, at windows365.microsoft.com. For about 30 minutes, it wasn't ready. It said setting up cloud PC, but then after that, it had the option to click to open in browser, or alternatively, you could access it via a remote desktop app on any platform, Windows, Mac, iOS, or Android, but I'll just use the web browser for now. And in the web interface, it has you log in, and then you have some basic navigation stuff at the top, which lets you, for example, open full screen, do some basic settings for the remote connection, and also transfer files. And at that point, after you wait for the computer to boot up, it was just ready to go. So I decided to test it out. And I tried out just the basic PC first. So that's the one with the 2 CPUs and 4 gigabytes of RAM. Not much RAM, definitely not as much as I would like to have on a computer as my main one, but we'll try it out for the cloud PC. And once you're in there, it looks pretty standard. I mean, with the web interface maxed out full screen or the remote client maxed out, it kind of just looks like you're working on a regular Windows PC. There's really nothing in here that is any special that you can't do on a regular PC. So I decided let's kind of go into the specs, look to see what they're dealing with. It looks like it's running Intel Xeon CPUs. It's also running Windows 10 Enterprise. Also looks like there is no GPU apparently. So if you're wondering, can you game on this? Well, I'll address that and do a video benchmark in a minute. The main disk is 128 gigabytes, and there is also some kind of virtual disk at 16 gigabytes, which appears to be for transferring files. So for example, if you use the transfer files button at the top of the web interface, it goes into this uploaded folder in this thing and then you copy it over. So it's a little bit different than like a VNC program or something. Anyway, looking in the disk manager, it looks like they're kind of by default mapped to the C and D drive. So again, just pretty standard. When I was using this one, it definitely had a noticeable latency. So it could be pretty distracting. I wasn't sure if this was because it didn't have a lot of RAM and it was just a slow computer in general. Certainly some of it was because it was remote desktop. So I'll take a look at the more powerful one and tell you how that went in a minute. But continuing to just mess around, it again is just basically a standard PC. You can go and install software to it, assuming it's set up with admin permissions, which I mean, I did. And so I installed Google Chrome, had no issues. And yeah, it's just a bit regular looking PC here. So I figured I'd do some benchmarks and some tests. Supposedly these have a 10 gigabit internet connection because they exist in a Microsoft data center somewhere, which obviously have a massive internet connection. So I went on speed test and it wasn't exactly 10 gigabit. On the downside, it was 656 and on up, it was 3142. So obviously extremely fast, not quite the 10 gigabit. I don't know if it was maybe because there's a lot of people using this trial. They said they had unprecedented demand. Maybe not. I also did a quick disk benchmark with Crystal Disk Mark, that's software. And on this one, the read speeds sequential was about 210 megabytes per second with 160 megabytes per second writing. So really not any particularly fast storage. I'm not sure if they're using SSDs or hard drives here. It's certainly faster than what you kind of expect from a hard drive, which is usually like maybe 100, 150 megabytes per second, but definitely slower than even a SATA SSD. So they might just be running hard drives, or at least that's how the performance is what you're gonna get. And as for latency and lag, if you use the remote desktop app on the computer, not the web interface, it will actually show you the connection info and that latency. And it shows that for this 2-core, 4-gigabyte PC, there is a round trip latency of about 100 milliseconds. So that's probably why it was noticeable and a bit laggy when you click around stuff. It's definitely a feelable delay. So now let's move on to the more powerful. This is the premium one, which is like $60 plus, which is 4 cores and 16 gigabytes of RAM. The first thing I noticed is for some reason it didn't activate Windows in this one. So it gave me that message at the bottom right. I don't know what's up with that. But anyway, looking at the specs, it's also running with Xeon CPUs or virtual cores. I don't know what the deal is, but it's the same type of thing. And this one certainly already right off the bat seems a bit more responsive, probably because it has more RAM so it can simply load up the stuff I'm clicking on faster. And right off the bat, I can tell you that the remote desktop client this time says there is significantly less latency now at just 70 millisecond round trip, which is still kind of a lot. Like you wouldn't want to game on this or anything, but it's less noticeable than the lower spec PC. So now let's do another speed test. I want to see if the speed test last time was just because of the low CPU power or something. So this time the speed test said 970 down, 4392 up, and that's megabit. So certainly a little bit faster. I don't know if that has anything to do with the power of the computer, or maybe I just lucked out. Doing a disk test on this one, the read speeds are slightly higher. It's 250 megabytes per second read and 150 megabytes per second write sequential. So pretty much similar on writing and a little bit faster on reading. So yeah, this is not exactly any fantastic read and write speeds on this computer. Now you might be wondering, what's the video performance? Can you game on these things? And the answer is no, absolutely not. Don't even bother trying. I did a video test in a second, which I'll show you, but these don't even have a GPU as far as I know yet. Maybe they'll add them at some point in the future, which would probably increase the price a lot, but you're not gonna be able to run really anything on this computer. To give you some perspective, I ran the Heaven benchmark, which is from like 2009, and I also put it on the absolute minimum settings possible. So I turned off all the options, put it on the minimum resolution of just 640 by 360, and as a result, I got a whopping 2 frames per second. Yes, 2 frames per second, 2009 benchmark, lowest settings, not gonna be running any games on this anytime soon. Now I have to imagine that at some point in the future, Microsoft is gonna be adding some maybe GPUs, but more for like workstation type stuff. Like if you're running a CAD program, something like that, not exactly for gaming. Microsoft already has the xCloud, which is like a separate thing for Xbox. So if you wanna do gaming, that's probably the one to use. and that's going to be for streaming individual games. I don't know if they have like a virtual PC set up for that, but this is certainly obviously for business and productivity type stuff, not for gaming anyway. Now, to show you it working on different platforms and how it's persistent, it doesn't actually shut down when you close it, I opened up a Microsoft Word window, which there's no license on it, so it gives me a message, but then I closed out of this and then went on my phone, on an iPhone, downloaded the remote desktop app from Microsoft on there, and then was able to log into it, and you see, there it is as well. And it's not as easy to navigate with a mouse, obviously, but you can still get in there and get it from anywhere on your phone or any other device, like an iPad, Mac, smaller PC, whatever. Now, you might be wondering, all right, what exactly is the point of this? Because if you need a computer to access it, then what's the point of having this cloud PC? Well, really, it's probably for a couple of use cases, mostly for business. I think for any regular user, it's going to be almost useless, but there are potentially in the future, if they maybe beef up the computers, stuff like that, some uses for a regular person, such as being able to run Windows apps if you're mainly a Mac user. You just load up a virtual Windows PC instead of having to go buy one. Or if you want to be able to work on some stuff on your main computer and then load it onto the virtual computer, and it'll be persistent as you continue to work on it when you go to work, something like that. At the moment though, for now, really the only benefit is, I think, gonna be for businesses. So for example, a lot of times businesses need to deploy lots and lots of computers to a bunch of different employees. And this way they can mass deploy virtual computers way easier than they might with a actual physical computer, because this actually allows you to do some stuff such as custom images, so they can load up a specific image with pre-installed software, pre-installed settings, or they can add settings and manipulate the settings virtually, and it's just gonna happen instantly because it's all in the cloud, and then so it's easier to manage these computers and the security of them and stuff like that. You're not gonna ever have to worry about the user losing the virtual PC and then worrying about if the data on there just got stolen, stuff like that. And the computer is certainly powerful enough to do some basic word processing, office applications, productivity stuff, but again, none of that you really need a GPU for, so it kind of makes sense that they wouldn't even add that on there. Another benefit for businesses is it apparently allows you to remotely install software instantly, whereas depending on how the computer and system is set up at a company, they might have to send an IT guy down to install the program and log in with the admin credentials. I'm sure there's some way to do some of that remotely, but this just makes it way more easier to do it to maybe everyone at once. And another thing is the companies now can have the main virtual CPU that they're going to be working on, the employees, and then they could issue some basic super cheap laptops that are only powerful enough to really access the cloud, and then the company doesn't have to worry about the users banging them around or breaking them or losing them, whereas if they lost a really good powerful computer, then they'd have to replace it, and that would be a more costly expense. And this has the benefit of the actual computer being always up to date and being able to update stuff on it quicker. But for a regular user like you or me, I think this is extremely pointless for one main reason, which is they're not cheap. They're pretty expensive for what you're getting. I mean, $24 a month for what I would consider an unusable PC, 2 gigabytes of RAM, 1 core, I would not want to use that on anything. And on that one, it's hilarious because it recommends using the web versions of Office apps, not even regular apps. So it's like you're connecting to a cloud PC to use web versions of apps. It's like, what is the point of that? So if a regular person was going to sign up for one of these, they'd probably go for one of the more affordable options, which is going to be an extremely basic computer, no GPU or anything. And then they're still gonna have to have a computer that will allow them to access that. So they're still gonna have to go out and buy a basic computer that's probably gonna be just as powerful as the one they're paying for in the cloud. And at that point, they can pretty much get a lot of the functionality from just using a cloud syncing service like Dropbox or OneDrive or something. Not exactly any point to using it for a regular user. Still, it's important to remember that this is the first generation of this, that they just launched it for a very specific purpose. So don't necessarily say, oh, this is stupid, because it's not really made for regular users. And I believe Microsoft has said there's the possibility of this kind of service being rolled out for general users, but I don't think they have any specific plans that they've announced for that anytime. So let me know what you think down in the comments. Maybe I didn't think of a use that you personally would imagine would be awesome as a personal user for if they do eventually roll it out. Also, if you enjoyed this video, be sure to give it a thumbs up and be sure to subscribe because I try to make a couple videos a week. If you guys want to keep watching, the next video I'd recommend is talking about how you might be using your computer monitor wrong. It's probably not what you think, so I'll put that link right there. I think you'll be interested in that. So thanks so much for watching, guys, and I'll see you in the next video.